Good afternoon. I'm Stuart McLaurin, president of the White House Historical Association. Welcome to our second of three episodes this week, honoring and celebrating the birthday of our founder, First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy. 2021 will be the 60th anniversary of our association. And remember yesterday we spoke of Mrs. Kennedy only being 31 years old when her husband was elected president. She was First Lady for less than 3 years, but what she put in place in terms of historic preservation, conservation, the process and procedures at the White House for those matters, acquisitions for the permanent White House collection, those are the process and procedures that are still in place today. And we are a key part of that process established and created by Mrs. Kennedy to be the private partner to the White House. Our role is the same, regardless of who the president and first lady may be, and has been for 11 presidents and first ladies since the Kennedys almost 60 years ago. The legacy that Mrs. Kennedy instilled in us goes beyond the work at the White House. It is also education. It was very important to her that we teach and tell the stories of the White House and its history, and we do so through our wonderful publications, the White House History Quarterly, our education public programs, our teacher institute, the wonderful resources that are available on our website, whitehousehistory.org. And you know, as challenging as the past 5 months have been, and have been so for the entire nation, we've been busier than ever. We've been generating more content, disseminating to more users than at any comparable 5 month period in the 60 year history of the association. And I owe a debt of gratitude to my colleagues who are doing a terrific job in that regard. I'd also like to thank the members of our board of directors, past and present, who give oversight, leadership, and governance to our work. And they are a terrific group of leaders, and we're grateful to have their support. Also like to say thank you to the National Council on White House History. They've been very supportive of these events this week, and had we done our event in New York in person, as we would traditionally do, they would have been present and supportive in bringing new potential members of that council to that lunch. But if you're interested in joining the National Council on White House History or in supporting our work, all of that information is on our website, whitehousehistory.org. I mentioned my colleagues, and they are a terrific group to work with. One of them you'll hear from today will be moderating our program. Dr. Colleen Shogan is Senior Vice President of the Association and is Director of the David M. Rubenstein National Center for White House History. She'll be introducing and later having a conversation with Dr. Barbara Perry, who directs the Presidential Studies Program at the Miller Center at the University of Virginia. Dr. Perry is a great friend of the Association, and I admire her as a wonderful scholar and expert on presidential history and with great knowledge about President and Mrs. Kennedy. I know you're going to enjoy hearing from her today. So with that, I will turn it over to Colleen and Barbara. Thank you again for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you with us again tomorrow evening.
Thank you, Stuart. Good afternoon to everyone. It's a pleasure to introduce our presenter today. Barbara Perry is the Gerald L. Baliles Professor and Director of Presidential Studies at the University of Virginia's Miller Center, where she co-directs the Presidential Oral History Program. She is the author or editor of 14 books on presidents, first ladies, the Kennedy family, the Supreme Court, civil rights, and civil liberties. Professor Perry has conducted over 100 interviews for the George H.W. Bush, George W. Bush, Bill Clinton, and Barack Obama presidential oral history programs. And she also directs the Edward Kennedy Oral History Project. She served as a U.S. Supreme Court Fellow for Chief Justice William Rehnquist and has worked for both Republican and Democratic members of the United States Senate. Her books include 42, Inside the Presidency of Bill Clinton, 41, Inside the Presidency of George H.W. Bush, Rose Kennedy, The Life and Times of a Political Matriarch, Jacqueline Kennedy, First Lady in the New Frontier, Edward Kennedy, An Oral History, and The Priestly Tribe, The Supreme Court's Image in the American Mind. We welcome Dr. Perry to the program, and just as a quick reminder, we will have time for questions from the audience at the conclusion of our program. So if you do have questions for Dr. Perry, please type them in, and we'll get to as many as possible at the conclusion of the program. Welcome, Barbara.
Colleen, thank you so much. Thanks for that lovely introduction, and thank you to Stuart as well for his superb leadership of this wonderful association. I'm proud to be a member, and I have over my shoulder today my John F. Kennedy Christmas ornament that comes with membership, and I can't wait to put it on my Christmas tree this coming season for the holidays. Thank you too to Luke and Robert, who are helping us with the technology and putting this program together, and all those at the association who make this just such a wonderful set of programs to celebrate Mrs. Kennedy's birthday, which is today. So with that, we're going to do a presentation of about 20 minutes or so that will obviously not cover all the details of Mrs. Kennedy's life or first ladyship. But if Robert can bring up the PowerPoint presentation, we can get started with that. And then, as Colleen said, we look forward to your questions and your comments, not only about the presentation, but any elements of Mrs. Kennedy's life, and again, her first ladyship, or perhaps even after her first ladyship. But we're going to focus on her time in the White House today. So if I can have Robert go to the next slide. We want to talk about Mrs. Kennedy today in light of the tremendous symbols and imagery that surrounded her first ladyship and the Kennedy presidency, that she was very straightforward in putting together and just very detailed in how she went about this. But I love to have some sort of a hook on which we can hang those symbols and those images that she developed. Some, again, were quite forceful and that she was deliberate in, and some were just like how she looked. And so to do that, I borrowed a definition from a political science colleague of mine, the late Barbara Hinckley, who wrote a book called The Symbolic Presidents and Symbolic Presidency. And the subtitle was How Presidents Present Themselves. And her definition, as you'll see on the screen, was that political symbols convey a range of meaning beyond themselves, that is, beyond just what we might see in the symbolism and what we might see in the object. And that symbol conveyed a moral or emotional or psychological impact. And then I think the second part of the definition is even more intriguing, and which is why I emphasized it. And that is that Barbara Hinckley said that a political symbol doesn't need to be in that moral, psychological, or emotional impact. It doesn't need to be true in and of itself, but it will tap into ideas people want to believe in is true. And so I saw in Stuart speaking, for example, the American flag behind him. That's a perfect example of a symbol. Are we a perfect country? No, but we are a great country. As George H.W. Bush said, we're a good country and we're a good people. And people will indeed give their lives for that symbol. It's a piece of cloth. It's red, white, and blue with stars, but it symbolizes our country. So with the next slide, we'll see how Mrs. Kennedy in some ways couldn't help but be symbolic. And that is that Stuart mentioned she was only 31 when she came to the White House, among our youngest first ladies. And it just so happened that she had been preceded by older first ladies. So Lou Hoover and Eleanor Roosevelt and Bess Truman and maybe Eisenhower, all great first ladies to be sure, but they were older. They were in their 50s and in their 60s. They had older children. Some of them already had grandchildren in the White House. And because of their age group and because of the time and the fashions in which they lived, it just was such a contrast and so refreshing when Mrs. Kennedy came on the scene. You'll see here this photo of her and President Kennedy visiting Mexico in 1962. And part of the substance of her was her multilingualism, so fluent in French and fluent in Spanish. So she could step to the microphone and speak in the native tongue of a country she and the president might be visiting. But also look at the difference in her fashion, this beautiful bright pink suit that was sleeveless. I don't think you would have seen. Her dark brunette hair, and that it was always sort of done in a new, fresh style, not the tight curls that women tended to have with permanence in that era. So with the next slide, we can see that in addition to how she looked, Stuart, of course, talked about some of her most important work as First Lady in restoring the White House. And on a scholarly note, I like to point out that it wasn't just that she thought that the White House should be historically accurate and beautiful, though that is what she helped to create and then in putting together the White House Historical Association and putting together committees that would ensure that the White House would always look this way and would always be up to date in its history and how it was presenting itself. It so happened that the Dean of Presidential Scholars at that time, a professor named Richard Neustadt, who taught at Columbia and then Harvard, had written a book in 1960, by coincidence, called Presidential Power. And instead of focusing on formal powers of the president, as are portrayed in the Constitution, which most scholars had focused on at the time, instead, he said that the power of the president is the power to persuade all of the constituencies at home and abroad that he must persuade in order to be successful. That sounds rather common now, but it was a different approach. And so in some ways, he brought the power of the president right to the person in the White House at the very moment that Mrs. Kennedy was restoring the White House and making it a symbol of our democracy, as it had been for many years, but in a new media age. She also created the guidebook. I have the picture at the top here on the left of, I think, the first edition that she produced and the current edition for the White House Historical Association. And my first trip to the White House when I was in high school, that was my parents' graduation gift to me, was I still have my guidebook and my book about the presidents that are signed by Mrs. Nixon, because she was the first lady when I arrived for the first time at the White House. And I always remember sitting in beautiful Lafayette Square one evening with my mother across the street, across Pennsylvania Avenue. And I said, "Mother, someday, I don't know how, but this is, I know, going to be my lifelong passion. And I'm going to be a part of this in some way." And so just simply by being a member of the White House Historical Association, I get to have that feeling. But by being able to work at the Supreme Court and work in the executive branch over the years, as well as teach about the White House and those who've occupied it, I feel like my dream has come true. And then the tour that Mrs. Kennedy gave in 1962 of the redecoration process and the rooms that had been completed by then, that went around the world. And the USIA, the US Information Agency, was able to send that even behind the Iron Curtain. And at the very end of the documentary that she made with Charles Collingwood, President Kennedy makes a cameo appearance, and he talks about the importance of the White House as a symbol in the Cold War of democracy. Well, if we can have the next slide, please. They also, the Kennedys did, use state entertainment as a way to showcase the White House. By my count, they had in their little over 1,000 days in the White House, 16 state dinners. One of the dinners they had, the Nobel Laureate dinner that many people remember, where President Kennedy famously said it was the greatest assemblage of talent at the White House since Thomas Jefferson had dined alone. So since I'm sitting here in Charlottesville, the birthplace of Thomas Jefferson, I thought I might mention that. But notice the picture at that dinner in the bottom left of Pearl Buck holding forth with President Kennedy and Mrs. Kennedy leaning in to talk to the poet Robert Frost. This was just the showcase as well of Nobel laureates throughout the Western Hemisphere, but also the state dinners of bringing in those heads of state from around the world. The president of Pakistan and his wife, and Mrs. Kennedy created this beautiful state occasion at Mount Vernon, where guests were boated down the Potomac to Mount Vernon. And even notice her dress that evening sort of represented the columns of Mount Vernon, but also the revolutionary spirit that created our country, the revolutionary spirit of Pakistan. She thought that that would be an interesting parallel. And then the other point that is so important about the state dinners is that the Kennedys reached out to, at that time, we would have called them third world leaders. Now we would say developing nations. But so many of the nations in Africa, in Latin America and South America were unaligned. They hadn't cast their lot with the Soviets and communism or with the leaders of the free world, including the United States. And many of them were Black and brown leaders of Black and brown people. And so the Kennedys went out of their way, as in the case of entertaining the president of the Ivory Coast and his wife. And so that created symbolism as well. We can have the next slide. In addition to using the White House as a showplace for the arts, which we'll see momentarily with Pablo Casals, for example, Mrs. Kennedy, as Stuart mentioned, also brought to the United States through a working that she did, a collaboration with the French, to have them loan us the Mona Lisa for exhibits in Washington and in New York City. And Stuart was very kind to give me the first edition of this book by Margaret Leslie Davis. And of course, she will be speaking to you tomorrow evening. But it's just an amazing book about this amazing experience to have brought this masterpiece to the United States. So in this picture, you see the president on the left, Mrs. Malraux to his left in the black dress, then the portrait of the Mona Lisa, and then André Malraux, who was the great, great author, the French author. Mrs. Kennedy loved his literature. He was the cultural minister of France. And then Mrs. Kennedy in her beautiful off-the-shoulder, just light pink gown, had seed pearls sewn into it, and Vice President Johnson to her side. I do want you to note how Mrs. Kennedy is standing next to Malraux, and you notice she was leaning into Robert Frost. She had this way of making people feel close to her, and this was actually a source of her power as well, that she would sort of sidle up to people and speak very intimately with them. And some people call that soft power on the part of first ladies and sometimes women in even public office, but I think it's sometimes overlooked at how powerful that can be. In the next slide, then, I'd mentioned the Casals visit to the White House. Pablo Casals had come to the White House and played the maestro of the cello for Theodore Roosevelt in the early 20th century. But he was boycotting the United States because it had recognized the fascistic government of Francisco Franco. Casals had left his native Spain because of the Civil War in the 1930s and because Franco had come to power, and he was self-exiled in Puerto Rico. And so he was boycotting the United States. But this young new couple, the new frontier of the Kennedys, gave him such hope that he offered to come to the White House and play, and he did. And I love this photograph of him kissing Mrs. Kennedy's hand in the East Room of the White House. But Mrs. Kennedy also was able to expand the arts by making the White House a stage for the arts. Remember, we didn't yet have our National Cultural Center, which became the Kennedy Center. She worked to support that in her time as First Lady and after, but we didn't have that yet. So we really didn't have a national stage. And this was part of the Cold War message too, that the United States had a cultural history. And I love Stuart's term of Mrs. Kennedy and her cultural diplomacy. This also fit right in with President Kennedy's policies that he explained, especially in the fall of 1963, his speech on the arts at Amherst College and dedicating the Frost Library there, about the importance of arts and the representation of arts in a free democracy. Next slide, please. I didn't think that Lafayette Square would be quite in the news as it has been when I put together this presentation, but we need to thank Mrs. Kennedy for preserving it, because in the Eisenhower administration, there had been a movement supported by the president to take down the beautiful 19th century townhomes surrounding Lafayette Square, which in a way is viewed as an adjunct to the White House. It's sort of the president's park, if you will. And one of those townhomes was Dolly Madison's, where she had lived after the presidency and after her husband had died. And Mrs. Kennedy got wind that that might be torn down to put up new high-rise office buildings for the burgeoning federal bureaucracy. And she approached her husband and asked if that could be held off. They brought in their mutual friend, Jack Warnicke, the West Coast architect who specialized in historic preservation. And you can see him and Mrs. Kennedy with an architectural rendering of what it now looks like at Lafayette Square, that these low-rise red brick office buildings for the federal offices are there to this day, but so are the beautiful townhomes, the historic townhomes. And the office buildings almost fade into the background. You almost don't even notice they are there. So with that, we'll move to the next. And part of that diplomacy, in addition to the cultural side that Stuart mentioned, was that Mrs. Kennedy was a goodwill ambassador. So when she traveled with her husband in that their famous trip to Paris in 1961, the United States was having a little bit of difficulty with, we thought an ally, he certainly was an ally, Charles de Gaulle, but he often wanted to go his own way. And so in the Cold War alliance of the four powers, certainly the three that were now democracies and holding tight to the free world, the Soviets going their own way into leading the communist world, crusty old de Gaulle could sometimes be difficult, but you can see he's completely mesmerized by Mrs. Kennedy here. She could speak fluent French to him from her year abroad, her junior year abroad when she was in college, she spent in France. And she usually wore Ole Cassini gowns and suits here because he was an American designer. But when in Paris, where's Givenchy? And here she is at the state dinner that the French threw for her and President Kennedy at Versailles. In the middle picture is intriguing to me as well because she'd also accompanied her husband on that trip to the summit in Vienna where he was having a difficult meeting with Khrushchev, the head of the Soviet Union. Mrs. Kennedy was being the goodwill ambassador with Mrs. Khrushchev, and she is the woman, the second from the right in the fairly long suit that's quite bold in its floral design. And she apparently was a lovely woman. Mrs. Khrushchev was very well educated, multilingual. But as a bit of a joke, I always say if you were an unaligned country and you had to choose whether to go with the Americans or the Soviets, and you could only decide based on the presentation and how the first lady of that country looked, I think you might choose Mrs. Kennedy. Mrs. Kennedy also did a semi-official visit to India and Pakistan. In 1962, she went with her sister, Lee, and just the very fact that she could approach both of those countries and both of those leaders when tensions were often very taut between them. Here she is with Nehru. Just a wonderful goodwill visit, and the USIA filmed that and sent that around the world too. Next, please. And Vienna, as I mentioned, in addition to being a goodwill ambassador with Mrs. Khrushchev, Mrs. Kennedy was also a goodwill ambassador with Premier Khrushchev. And even though he had, according to President Kennedy, savaged President Kennedy at the summit with very tough talk, when he came to the state dinner with the Kennedys at Schönbrunn Palace that evening, he said that he wanted to shake Mrs. Kennedy's hand. And she was wearing a beautiful sort of beige colored sparkling gown. And the Washington Post made the comment that Khrushchev looked like a Russian schoolboy on the banks of the Volga River in the spring when the snow melts because he was aglow. And it may be apocryphal, but the story is that he was trying to impress Mrs. Kennedy by telling her how many tractors the Soviet Union produced each year. And that she said, "Oh, Mr. Chairman, don't bore me with statistics." And so she began to think, what could she talk to him about? So she started talking to him about the dogs that the Soviets were sending into space. But you can see that there's sort of a mutual delight there. So in this instance, I say, per my title, that she's both a cold warrior in her diplomacy, but also a beautiful style icon as well. If we could go to the next, please. And just at the time that Mrs. Kennedy is portraying herself in this way, she's also working with the modern media, the beautiful Life magazines that had gone color with their glossy photos. And those of you who remember Life magazine, they're about this big, and we got them every week at our home. We saved many of them. I have many of these from the Kennedy era. But this is Mrs. Kennedy on the one on the left, portrayed in Life magazine in a red suit and a red pillbox hat, her signature hat. She'd asked Cassini to put that outfit together when she met with the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. And this was in May of 1961. This was the Kennedys' first trip outside the country together. And then with Charles Collingwood there in the middle for the tour of the White House. But even when she was in a rather sedate beige look, look at how beautiful she appears on the Truman balcony of the White House with the Washington Monument behind her. So the glossy color magazines, her coloring, her beauty and her clothing, the TV, even though it was still black and white, still looked so beautiful. The newsreels of that day that were still shown. And then again, the USIA documentaries that went around the world. Very important for the imagery of the United States. And the next slide, please. Now, sadly, we're coming towards the end of her first ladyship, and there were two tragedies that the family suffered. We know, of course, how the presidency ends, but Mrs. Kennedy and President Kennedy lost their baby Patrick in August of 1963. And here, this beautiful family with Caroline and John, they are here pictured at Cape Cod with the family canines. But it was just after Mrs. Kennedy lost their premature baby. Patrick lived only 2 days, but he had a lung ailment that at that time could not be treated. It was very common in premature babies. Even just a couple of years later, it was able to be treated. He would have lived. But the president had brought from Washington the family canines and trying to boost their morale at a sad time. But this imagery of this beautiful young family, we really hadn't had such a young family in the White House since the Theodore Roosevelt. The grandchildren, yes, of some presidents, but not these young children of the president and the first lady. And at the time, this is the baby boom. So my mother took me to see John F. Kennedy when I was 4 years old, and she was a homemaker in the suburbs. And she packed my brothers and me into the car and drove us to downtown Louisville and put us in front of the podium. She got there early to see then Senator Kennedy 1 month before he was elected. We are Catholic. I know that was very meaningful to my mother and my grandmothers and my parents and grandparents to have the first Catholic president. And I think my mother, as many people did, could relate to Mrs. Kennedy because she was in their age group, and as my mother was, and all the mothers of baby boomers, she was raising a young family. So we may have the next, please. I always say when I come to this portion that if I could wave a magic wand and wish away what happens after this, I would do it. But we do know that this is what happens is that Mrs. Kennedy agreed to accompany her husband on what was really going to be the first kickoff campaign trip of the 1964 reelection campaign, to go to Texas, make a tour through Texas in order to mend fences in the Democratic Party there and raise money for 1964. And they arrived looking so beautiful at Love Field, November 22nd, 1963 in Dallas, getting ready for the motorcade into the city. If we may have the next, please. And yes, in the motorcade, as we know, the president suffered a fatal wound. And Mrs. Kennedy, despite having just lived through that horrific experience, it is beyond comprehension to me that on Air Force One, sitting on the tarmac in Love Field, that she could honor the new president and the new first lady, Lyndon Johnson and Lady Bird Johnson. They asked if she would come and stand with them for the swearing-in ceremony. And you can see the look of utter shock on her face. But again, she summoned from deep within her the courage to do that. And then if we may have the next slide. And then she became, I believe, our mourner in chief for our country. And as her brother-in-law, Edward Kennedy, would eulogize her when she passed in 1994, he said, in those four horrible days of 1963, she not only held our family together, but she held our country together. So here she's pictured leaving the Capitol Rotunda, where the ceremony had taken place for the lion in state of the president, Bobby Kennedy, the attorney general, the president's brother, Pat Kennedy Lawford, the president's sister, and young Caroline and John with their mother. And how she was able to do that in the glare of public spotlights to maintain her composure is beyond me. In the next photo, we will see another element of her profile and courage from those 4 days, that on that Monday of the president's funeral on November the 25th, she and Edward Kennedy came back to the White House after the funeral because Mrs. Kennedy thought it was her duty to greet and thank for coming the diplomats and the presidents and the heads of state from around the country who had also marched with her up Connecticut Avenue from the White House, led by Charles de Gaulle, led by Haile Selassie of Ethiopia, and went to St. Matthew's Cathedral in Washington for the funeral service. So she somehow managed to stay on her feet and perform that last diplomatic duty for herself and for her husband. And then they went upstairs, if you can imagine this, to the residence to mark the third birthday of John Jr. It was his third birthday, the day of his dad's funeral. Next, please. Everyone is very familiar, I'm sure, with the eternal flame marking the president's gravesite at Arlington Cemetery, just down from the Custis Lee Mansion and overlooking Washington. The president had made a comment on a visit to this area for a Veterans Day ceremony that he looked out over Washington and said, I could stay here forever. Some of the members of the family wanted him to be buried in Boston, but President because he had made this comment, Bobby Kennedy and Mrs. Kennedy thought the perfect place for him would be Arlington. So he is there now with Mrs. Kennedy and their two children, Patrick and a stillborn daughter they had in the 1950s. And it's just such a beautiful, peaceful sight. This is actually a photo I took a couple of Easters ago with the tulip trees or the Japanese magnolia blooming. And that flame, Mrs. Kennedy wanted to represent a symbol, the president saying in his inaugural address, the torch has been passed to a new generation. The glow from that fire will truly light the world. And Mrs. Kennedy had seen such a flame flickering under the Arc de Triomphe in Paris at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. So to this day, you can see the flame flickering there in Arlington. And next, please. And these last few slides will show you this concept that I think allows the presidency, the first ladyship of the Kennedys, to continue to remain in our mind, because Mrs. Kennedy gave to the presidency of her husband a label that really took hold. And remember back to that definition of political symbolism. Mrs. Kennedy said that one of the president's favorite show tunes was from Camelot, the play that ran on Broadway during their presidency. And she said, there'll be great presidents again, but there'll never be another Camelot, that golden age that she wanted people to think of when they thought of her husband's thousand-day presidency. And she spoke this very carefully and creatively to Theodore White, the journalist, the columnist for Life magazine. She called him to Hyannisport 1 week after her husband's assassination, and she asked him to use that label, and he did, and it has stuck to the very end. Next slide, please. And I think the power of that symbol of Camelot is that it tapped into not only what people wanted to think about and remember from the Kennedy administration and Mrs. Kennedy's first ladyship, but it also tapped into another legend, and that is the legend of King Arthur, the Arthurian legend of the mythical King of England who ruled in a golden age. And so she took that that set of lyrics from Lerner and Lowe, from Julie Andrews, and from Richard Burton, who had been in the Broadway play, Don't Let It Be Forgot That Once There Was a Spot for One Brief Shining Moment Known as Camelot. Next, please. And what was true about it was, in many ways, it was a golden age. As Robert Frost had said at the inaugural, certainly a golden age of the arts. It was a golden age of reaching out to the world. And it was literally brief, only a little over 1,000 days, and it was shining. There was something effervescent about this young couple and this young family, and particularly in contrast to President Eisenhower, the previous president, who was 70 when he left office, and at that time was our oldest president. He had been somewhat sickly, but 70 years of age, the exact age of the president's mother. So to have a new generation that, as I explained, my mother could really relate to, my dad, a World War II vet, as was President Kennedy, it was a new generation, and it was shining and effervescent. And now the last slide, I believe. And so just when people ask about how did Mrs. Kennedy's first ladyship fit into the concept of women's history, she was, I think, astride of both the traditionalism of her motherhood, of her marriage to the president, of raising her young children in the White House, which she said was the most important thing. But she was modern, and she knew the concept of the modern media. And so in many ways, and I think she had one foot in the camp of traditionalism and one foot in what would become the modern women's movement. And in her post-first ladyship, she could really come into her own. So with that, thank you so much. A happy birthday to Mrs. Kennedy, and I now look forward to Colleen moderating our comments and questions from you.
Thanks so much, Barbara, for that terrific presentation. We do have a lot of questions that are coming in, so we'll try to get to as many as possible. The first question is from George, and he asks, is there any real definition of the duties of a first lady? Is it a merely symbolic role, or is it really a significant role, a significant political role?
Well, that's a great question, George. The answer to the first is there is no set of duties given to the First Lady, because, as you indicate, it's an unofficial position and therefore one that the First Lady makes it. But every First Lady has contributed in some way, either through her marriage and through her being a helpmate to her husband and his political career, Or I would say at one extreme, if you look at a continuum of first ladies and their involvement in policy, would be someone like Eleanor Roosevelt, who in some ways was a co-president, in part because of FDR's issues related to his mobility. She was able to get out in the world and literally travel the world, but she also had longstanding interests in many policies. And I would put Mrs. Kennedy a bit towards the middle category of that continuum where, yes, she used the symbolism of the first ladyship and she added to it, but her policy concerns also related to preserving the White House at a time in the Cold War, which was particularly important, her cultural diplomacy, I'm now borrowing Stuart's phrase again, and the arts. But particularly because of the Cold War, because of our attempts to get those unaligned nations over to us, that symbolism, I argue, was especially important during the Cold War. But first ladies do have to be careful because Eleanor Roosevelt came in for a lot of criticism for being too powerful or attempting to be too powerful. And we have to remember that first ladies are unaccountable. They are unelected. So they have to find that sweet spot, which I think most modern first ladies have, of picking one issue in particular and focusing on that, as well as carrying out the symbolic duties of the first ladyship.
The next question is from Deborah. How did Mrs. Kennedy make the White House grounds a strong setting for the presidency?
Well, Deborah, thank you for that question. Yes, I'm so glad that you asked because I write about this in my book on Mrs. Kennedy, that she also had, as did the president, an interest in how the symbolism of the White House grounds appeared. And again, many other presidents and first ladies had taken an interest in using the gardens and creating formal gardens over the years. But Mrs. Kennedy actually wrote out a long, long list of things that she noted needed to be done differently about the lawn. For example, she said, why does the lawn look so brown? And it needs to be green all the time and it needs to be manicured. And she and the president wanted it to look that way as a beautiful setting for the executive mansion, but also as a place where they could greet and bring in foreign dignitaries. They didn't really want to take the time and go to the frowsy National Airport or the frowsy Union Station at those times. It took time out of their schedule, and those were just not very beautiful settings. And so they said, let's really make this a showplace. In addition to that, President Kennedy asked Bunny Mellon to redo the Rose Garden so it would be a stage for when he could bring not only heads of state in, but Peace Corps volunteers, the Boys Nation, and the very famous picture of a 16-year-old Bill Clinton shaking hands with President Kennedy in the Rose Garden. That was the idea that President and Mrs. Kennedy had, was to create a showplace both inside the White House and on the outside. And they also put together beautiful concerts, particularly for disadvantaged children in Washington, to invite them to the White House grounds when the weather permitted to see concerts and listen to concerts. And I should also note that I saw that our current First Lady, Mrs. Trump, is going to update the Rose Garden. So I think Mrs. Kennedy and President Kennedy would be pleased that it's continuing to be used as a stage and a venue for presidents.
Our next question is from one of our National Council members, Meta Kroc. Do you believe at the end of Mrs. Kennedy's life that she looked back and looked at her own life as being a happy one?
Oh, how can we judge the views that people have of themselves and their lives? But I will tell you that she wrote a very personal note to her and her the president's friend, Bill Walton, the artist. And she said during her White House time, she said, I really dreaded coming to the White House for fear of loss of privacy. What would be the impact on her two young children? Remember, they're the only president and first lady to have a baby between the election and the inauguration. So they come to the White House. The children don't come immediately, but quite soon they do arrive, three-year-old Caroline and infant John Jr. So she understandably was really worried, what would be the impact of living in this fishbowl? And she wrote to Bill Walton about halfway through her time in the White House and said, it's the happiest time I've known because I've been able to get control of the things that I need to do. I can, you know, farm out those things that I don't want to do. But I get to live in the same home with my husband, whereas before he would be out on the road so frequently campaigning and when he was in the Senate. And this way, his office was at home. He had a home office. So she said at that point, it was so happy. Now, obviously, the tragedies at the end of the presidency took their toll. But I think certainly towards the end of her life, she seemed to have found real happiness with Maurice Templesman. Her children were doing well. She had grandchildren, one in fact named for her husband, Jack, and two granddaughters from Caroline. And I think that at the end, she was a happy person. And she'd also had her own career in publishing and historic preservation, saving Grand Central Station in New York. So I think looking back, despite the terrible tragedies she had endured, I think she would have said on balance she had had a happy life. And we certainly are appreciative and know she had a very productive life and contributed so much to our country.
That's very interesting. First Lady Michelle Obama wrote something similar in her biography, in Becoming, that she actually got to spend more time with President Obama after he'd been elected president than when he was running for president. Our next question is from Jeff. Jackie Kennedy was often criticized for being too French. Did that affect her activity in the White House and her public duties?
Yes, Jeff, she says in her oral history that she did with Arthur Schlesinger, starting just a little bit of time after the end of the White House year. So in March of 64, she did 8 hours of oral history, which are now available. She said that it was ironic to her that when her husband was running for Senate and when he was running for president, that she would sometimes be accused of being too European or too French or being too high society and not a woman of the people in her clothing and the way she spoke and the fact that she could speak fluent French. And the way she put it was, she said, I didn't bake bread and have flour up to my elbows. But she said, ironically, when I became First Lady, those all seemed to be pluses. And I think she's absolutely right about that, that while she did have to be careful about what she wore and whether she was wearing American designs and how expensive they must be and might be. But she was very careful and very diplomatic about the cost of restoring the White House and put in place, as Stuart said, these mechanisms and these nonprofit organizations that would allow her to raise money in that way so she wouldn't have to be going to Congress and asking for money, because she didn't want to be in the position that Mary Todd Lincoln ended up in, which was viewed as a spendthrift, both by her husband and as by the American people during the Civil War. So Mrs. Kennedy just said it was an irony, but what was viewed as in criticism as a weakness became a strength, probably because of this cultural diplomacy that she was able to make use of her European background and her fluent speaking of French and Spanish.
And our last question before we go to our special presentation at the end is a question from James. Mrs. Kennedy was keenly aware of the image and legacy of her husband and herself. Could you comment on how she preserved and honored that legacy of both JFK and herself throughout her life?
Yes. Well, of course, it starts with the Camelot legacy and that legend being layered upon the Arthurian legend. And then from that, it becomes much more than symbolism. It becomes literally concrete with the beautiful Kennedy Library at Columbia Point in South Boston, where I did most of the research on Mrs. Kennedy for my book. Now, most of her papers are still not released, but there are obviously many other people who corresponded with her, like Arthur Schlesinger. So you can see many correspondences that he had with her about the guidebooks, about the White House Historical Association. So the Kennedy Library, particularly, she went on TV just after the president's death in January of that next year to thank the American people from the some 800,000 condolence notes that came in. And she said, we're going to create a library for my husband, for his papers, for his archives, so that people for generations on will learn about him. The Kennedy Center, I believe, in Washington also is a concrete tribute to him and to her and the arts. And then also the Kennedy Institute of Politics at Harvard and the Kennedy School of Government, both carry on the tradition of learning about politics, learning about diplomacy, and learning about government. So I think all of those things, in addition to her own children, particularly Ambassador Caroline Kennedy serving in the Obama administration, in that sense too, Mrs. Kennedy's legacy continues as Caroline became the ambassador from the United States to Japan. And think about what that meant in history, that her father had almost been killed in World War II in fighting in the South Pacific, but to show you how history changes and how the American people do reach out to former enemies to become the ambassador to Japan was quite remarkable and quite important. And I'm sure President Kennedy and Mrs. Kennedy, I do believe there is an afterlife. I'm sure we're looking down with pride.
Thank you very much, Dr. Barbara Perry, for joining us this afternoon and providing such terrific insights about First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy. Now we have a special treat for you. Former Executive White House Pastry Chef Roland Mesnier has served five presidential administrations over 25 years in the White House. He will close our program today with a discussion about a special ending dessert served in the White House. One of my personal favorites.
The dessert is accompanied by petits. Could you tell us a little bit about that whole world of petits and why they're so important?
Yes. Petits is usually the last thing you will receive in a dinner party, okay? Any dinner. That's the ending, and usually champagne will be served with petits. That goes together. It's kind of a just to have a little sweet, a little thing towards the end of the meal. Now, you could have a petit four glacé, which is main glazed with chocolate, glazed with fondant, glazed with different things. And usually the cake part is the base is made with an almond biscuit. Very soft, very delicate. So we bake a whole sheet pan of that. And then they would be cut out. See, like here, we have heart, little heart, star, square, all sorts of different shape. And those would be glazed this time with chocolate. You can see the chocolate when it's still soft, but that will get hard later on. And usually, petit four are not bigger than one bite or maybe two bites maximum. That's it, you know, just but it has to be something exquisite. Exquisite in texture, in flavor, and the presentation. As a matter of fact, for petit four, we always put them on a tray with something else there, a decoration piece, and then they would serve you champagne with that, or coffee, depending. Sometimes people would request coffee.
As you encourage people to celebrate Mrs. Kennedy's birthday, I assume that the petit four, particularly the cookie, the petit four set, is something that people could attempt at home.
Definitely. If, like this one, very easy to make. The recipe, again, this is from one of our previous book, and recipes are in the book for that. And you wouldn't believe how delicious this is, that special almond cake, especially covered with chocolate.
Thank you, Chef, for those wonderful insights into a classic White House dessert. Probably easy for you to make, not so easy for me to make. But if you'd like to try, our books are available on our website at whitehousehistory.org. Our website also has terrific resources where you can learn more about Mrs. Kennedy and others who have lived and worked at the White House. As you know, we are a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that depends on support of individuals like you, and we appreciate your support during this challenging time. You can make a donation to the association by clicking on the Become a Part of History button below. If you have not yet registered for our program tomorrow at 5:30 Eastern Standard Time, you can do so on our website. We look forward to seeing you then as we continue our celebration of Mrs. Kennedy as the founder of the White House Historical Association. Have a terrific day and stay safe. Thank you.